So we kind of want to share with you what the end in mind is and what we're trying to do. But we are going to ask you to take the long view, because what we are trying to do cannot be done in a year. And at the same time that we're trying to build a different future that really is very different from our past, we are dealing with a tremendous budget cut. But we know this, that if we want different results, we cannot continue to do the same things we have been doing. But we also know that results come from multiple pieces coming together. It's not only one thing, but it's multiple stars aligning. So we want to start with the why. Superintendent Brownie, when he was running his campaign, he talked about why he was doing what he was doing. As you know, he was Secretary of State for many years. He didn't have to be a superintendent. But he's very committed to the community, and he always talked about the fulfilling the promise of college, career, and life readiness for each and every student. All of them, not some. So what is it going to take? So I want you to kind of think about, what does a graduate from the District School Board of Pasco County look like? And are they prepared for what comes after? Are they ready for what comes after? Are our graduates leaving us with all the opportunities that they can have? And if we think about what is it going to take, we all know about the deep academic knowledge. But the bottom line is, just academic knowledge doesn't cut it anymore. You have seen multiple studies saying if kids don't have the 21st century skills, the problem solving, the evaluation, the self-monitoring, perseverance, that they won't get jobs. So it's more than just the deep academic knowledge, it's also about 21st century skills and social emotional competencies. So the future that we're trying to create brings the whole child back to the table. Because since no child left behind, it was lost, okay? So we kind of have to start looking at where we are. Are we really paying attention to academic competencies, social, emotional, and 21st century competencies? And on the academic indicators, where are we? What does it look like? So we started looking at, and we know that this is just one indicator of learning. It's not everything, but it is an important indicator because it is how we are compared to other districts. And the bottom line is, as we have increased the targets, our district has fallen behind other districts. More of our students are not meeting proficiency, and more of our schools are falling below the state average. So that suggests there is a systemic issue. And when we look at key indicators, key grades, 5th to 6th, 8th to 9th, what I'm seeing is there are many kids moving on that are not prepared. And so high school problems do not begin in 9th grade. They begin in kindergarten. They really begin before that. But we have to start building a pathway that we can track, are our students on track to leave us after they graduate college, career, and life ready? So when you look at this, look at our 5th grade, our 8th grade, you can look at the other grades too. But the bottom line is, if my 5th graders don't enter 6th grade ready, I have a problem. If my 8th graders don't transition ready, I have a big problem. So when we start looking at where we are, we know that we need to do things differently. And it's not only overall achievement. When you start looking at our minority students, our low SES, and our advanced students, we have a systemic issue that we need to address together. So the decisions that we have to make, we have to focus on fulfilling this promise, okay? We cannot get away from that, because if we do, we lose our way. So our overall goals as we move forward really are around five main areas. We know we have to support the learning of district office, not only school, but district office. The district office folks need new knowledge and skills to better support schools. But our teachers also need new knowledge. Our leaders need new knowledge. It's not just one group of stakeholders. And you don't build that overnight. It is a journey, but we are committed to that journey. We also have to look at a different way of providing supports to schools. So we are looking at building regional and school-based experts. Years ago, when we were very successful, we did a lot of work through our mentor teachers, our teacher leaders, and then we kind of got away from that. And we are looking again at using our teacher leaders in a more meaningful way. Using a blended professional learning approach, we cannot do everything face-to-face. It is absolutely impossible. So we are looking at a blended approach to learning. And it just happens that our e-school is doing so well, and they are really expanding. There are other counties that are actually looking at contracting with our e-school, that they have funds to purchase a new platform that can help all of us, not just eSchool. So we are going to be purchasing Canvas that is going to help us with blended learning, to support blended learning, okay? Develop teacher leaders. I already talked a little bit about that. That's part of that local expert group. So we are going to develop teacher leaders and administrators. And as we all know, Common Core is coming. Actually, it's already here. We're a little bit behind on that, but we're going to catch up. But support the implementation of Common Core, and also a professional growth system and professional learning communities. Florida is an interesting place to be. They always enter the system through accountability. Not through what knowledge do I need to build, how do I build that knowledge, let people practice, give them feedback, and then align a measure of accountability with that knowledge. They always come in through the accountability first. And that's what happened with the teacher evaluation. We learned the instrument, but not really the framework. So we are kind of doing a reset on that. And yes, we know we don't have a choice about the teacher evaluation, but we also know that we can do a better job in building knowledge, helping people practice, giving them feedback before we align with the accountability system. Last is study success. One of the things we heard from multiple stakeholders was that the one size fits all did not work. We also heard from multiple stakeholders that they were not able to deviate from what they were doing, like at Trinity, Lacoochee, Hudson. Everything had to look the same. And it was not working. And teachers kept asking, there are two things we're asking you. We want to be treated like professionals, and we want to be able to teach. And we heard you. And we know that one size fits all does not work. So as we build this new knowledge that we all need to have, and we implement, we need to start studying what works for whom. What are the conditions? But Lacoochee and Trinity cannot look the same. It's not gonna work. It hasn't worked, okay? So how are we going to mobilize these services to schools? Right now, you know, you've heard about the budget constraints. It's difficult, it's hard. But we have been using, well, I'll let you talk about that good news. But you know it's hard. So what can we do with our existing staff? Can people be used in a different way? Can different roles be retooled to better serve this future? And how do we do this so people don't feel threatened? They don't feel like their jobs are at risk. It's hard. So we are looking at these things, and we were waiting for a miracle, but it didn't come. We know the results that we want. We know the situation that we have right now. But the bottom line is, we need to start looking at what are we going to do to get the results that we want. So the budget recommendations that Superintendent Browning has made to the board, and the board has asked us to come back and relook, really takes into account a multi-year process. It is not something that we're going to do everything at once. But we're not going to be able to build knowledge and support people if we don't have time to be with you face-to-face, developing you, or online. So we're going to, there are four premises that we are using. The first one is to invest in the future, adults and kids. The second one is really re-energize our efforts to increase achievement and close the gap. Okay? We are competing with charter schools, and now there's some pending legislation that could open e-schools, virtual schools, internationally. So we could be competing with virtual schools in Singapore, in Finland, in Canada. It's not just now in Florida, okay? So we really need to understand that we are competing and parents have lots of choice. And if we don't offer good choices, they don't have to stay. They don't have to stay, okay? So we need to keep that in mind. We need to manage the $23 million budget shortfall. And we also want to invest in our employees. People have not seen raises in 5 to 6 years. And we need to invest in people, okay? Some of our surrounding counties have higher salaries than we do, and that's not good for us. And we need to keep that in mind. So we are proposing to move forward by focusing on three different areas. Developing this professional growth system that includes the teacher evaluation, but that's not where it starts. Standards-based instruction, how does Common Core change what we're doing? And also professional learning communities. We cannot do this without collaboration, we cannot do this without planning time, it's impossible. So we're gonna need to have that. We started with the district office, and I know this is difficult for you to read, you will have it available electronically, but we started by transforming the district office. And we are still combining, blending some departments to diminish the silos and improve efficiency. We started with the top. We had four assistant superintendents. We're down to two. One takes care of the student achievement side, and then you have that other person. I don't know what they do. But anyway, but within the student achievement side, we collapsed instructional media and technology into it. What you do is critical, but districts really don't have a department that is separate. Okay, we were the only ones that had a department that was separate. And so when we started studying the high-performing districts across the country and also in our enrollment group, we have 13 counties in our enrollment group, what we saw was that you are part of teaching and learning, communication, IT. So your pieces were important, but they were in different places. But most of it fell really under teaching and learning. So as we have dissolved this department, it has really not gone away. We have moved most of it to teaching and learning. Part of it went to communications. Part of it went to technology and information services. And part of it went to professional development. We also blended student services and special education. So we really did start by looking at the district office. We are still making our reductions. We have reduced four directors on that side. And we are still looking at the supervisors, five secretaries. We will, because it is more efficient to do it that way. Then we started looking at how, because it's easy to move the chairs, it's easy to change names, but Superintendent Browning really talked about the philosophy of servant leadership. And the district office lives to serve the schools. That's why we exist. It is to serve the schools. So the learning community executive directors are in schools 4 days a week, and 1 day they are here. I'm in schools Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday mornings, and I'm at the district the rest of the time. But we have to be close to you to understand who you are so we can better serve you. The principals are to serve their staff. The staff really serves the students. And the students have to leave ready to serve their community. This is a shift in mindset. And not everybody likes that. Some people really like to tell people what to do. So not everybody's gonna be happy with the changes, but we are committed to building the new skills. Next, we divided the county into 4 different regions. Because if we want to prepare kids for their future, we cannot have people that think K-5, then they pass the kid on to 6-8, then they pass the kid on to 9-12. People have to be responsible for the continuum. So each of the learning community executive directors is responsible for pre-K through 12th grade in their region. They are the entry and exit point of services and technical assistance for their community. The regions have very different needs, and we cannot allocate supports and services in the same way. Okay? So this is where I'm going to pass to Superintendent Browning, and after he talks, I'll finish this component of how we are proposing to provide the services within the region. Okay, and
now
we'll take some questions afterwards.
Good deal. Thank you, Amelia. Glad you're here this afternoon. I have got to be in Dade City at 6:30 for speaking engagement, so I'm going to be here until 6:30 or 5:30, and then heading east at a very high rate of speed. Obviously, when I became superintendent, I was of the belief, and still am, that we need to change the culture of this district. We need to change the focus of the district, and everything need to be predicated on a simple driving question, and that was, is it best for the kids? And that is what we live by, is we ask ourselves a question when we budget, when we hire, when we adopt policies. Everything that we do has to be predicated on that question of, is it best for the kids? Obviously, we're practical, we're possible, but that is what drives us. We, as Amelia said, that this district, and I am hopeful, this is the last year that we have to look at cutting budgets. This district has gone on 6 years cutting budgets because of the economy and funding from the state legislature, and it's a result of the economy. And for those of you that weren't at the board meeting on Tuesday night, the Board of County Commissioners, the school board, directed the superintendent to come up with a different plan. And that was the first thing as related to media specialists and K-12 literacy coaches. The other thing that they wanted me to do was to plug the, what is not a $23 million hole, but a $19.5 million hole with recurring general revenue cuts. Without using non-recurring dollars. Non-recurring means they do not appear in the budget each and every year. So when you use non-recurring dollars, they're gone. And this district has, for the last number of years that we've been cutting budgets, have been robbing Peter to pay Paul. Sometimes it is a matter of necessity, other times it is, I think, a matter of convenience that you can plug a hole with non-recurring dollars. The board, really upon my insistence Tuesday night, was that we need to look at breaking the cycle. We have got to get off of non-recurring revenues. And that is the direction they've taken. Now, I will tell you that we worked, my staff worked all day yesterday after the board meeting on Tuesday night, identifying areas where there were going to be budget reductions, possible budget reductions. I will tell you that we've got to find another $5 million in general revenue to plug the hole to get us to the $19.5 million. Last night, the board used a word, and I don't know if the board used it, but I know that Mr. Solacek did today in his article, and that says that media specialists and K-12 literacy coaches received a reprieve. The reprieve is that you're still on the table. It's still part of the mix. I do not know how you plug $19 million when this district over the last 5 years has already picked, as I said, all the low-hanging fruit. We've made all the easy budget cuts. We've also made the budget cuts where there are large sums of money to cut. And this superintendent is kind of stuck in the middle with two competing interests. The first interest is, and not in this order, I've got to plug a $19.5 million hole. On the other side of this hole that I'm in is that I need to make sure that we move forward instructionally. We're ranked 34th out of 67 counties in this district and this state. I've said for over the last year that I'm not happy with 34th. 34th is mediocre, it's average, it's not where I like to be. We've got to see movement. You saw some of our scores, our reading scores, reading, math, science, writing, they're not where they need to be when you look at where we are. So my argument has been that whatever we're doing isn't necessarily working to get us to the point where we need to be. We've got to think outside the box, and we've got to change the way that we deliver education to our kids. It's imperative. And I will make the argument, and I will continue to make the argument, that until somebody can show me numbers, that can show me data, since everything that we are doing is data-driven, that what we're doing is not working. We've got to think of a different way to deliver the promise, as I've said, and that is the promise of a world-class education to all of our kids. We are, in fact, looking at combining media and technology specialist into a tech media specialist at the high school level, and looking at a literacy tech media specialist at the elementary schools. The difference is this: under my initial proposal to the school board, was that we were going to remove all the media specialists out of the schools, and we were going to make a full-time allocation of a media assistant. That's off the table. We are, in fact, putting a full-time media assistant in every school in our proposal, but we will also have in every school a full-time allocation at every school of this tech media position, which we'll be taking to the board if that's the route that we're going to be going. And I'll just tell you that the other 2 weeks ago at the board meeting, when the media specialists and their supporters came, and we welcome that, it's good for me to hear the comments from media specialists. But what concerned me was, as I sat in my chair and I'm taking notes of the comments that are being made by media specialists and their supporters, and the recurring word, there was a word that kept coming up over and over and over again with me, or to me, as I wrote it down. Anybody want to guess what the word is?
Technology.
Absolutely, technology. And I'm sitting there, and I do not play poker very well. If you ever watch, you watch my face, you can probably read me. Amelia's sitting here, and I'm looking at her going, this doesn't make any sense to me. If that's the case, what are my technology specialists doing? I'm not throwing anybody under the bus, I'm just telling you what I'm thinking during that meeting. And so the fact is that when you look at the comments that were being made, and I wrote them down, was that we're the ones that fix the computers. We're the ones that the teacher calls when there's a problem with the computer. We're the ones that install the software. We're the ones that replace the light bulbs and the projectors and on and on and on. I heard them with my own ears. So it when you look at that, I'm thinking we've got to be able to work differently in order to provide these services back to our schools. Amelia's going to go into details of what the regions are going to look like, the feeder patterns. But the equivalent, when everything is said and done, when everything is said and done with the media tech or tech media and the tech media literacy on the elementary side, it's the same amount of savings, which is a little bit higher, like $4.3 million. After we take all the positions out and add the positions in that we need to support these feeder patterns or these learning communities. Say, well, why do that then? Why bring the technology specialists in that? Because it's the other side of the whole that I'm talking about, and that is the way we deliver education. The way that we deliver education, the way we support our schools, meaning the way we support our teachers, the way we support our schools in those feeder patterns. We are never going to get where we need to be if we do not change the way we deliver it. We're just not going to get there. The goal was never to, and I would just let me put a pause in here. Could I have handled this first round a little differently? I'll be the first one to admit it. Yes, I sure could have. Do I still want to get where I want to get and take the district? Yeah, I really do. Why? Because in my opinion, and a lot of other folks' opinions, it's what's best for the kids. It's what's getting us to where we need to be. Now, I know that we will have a disagreement and we'll have difference of opinions, and that's all right. But I will tell you, I don't want to spend two more days like I spent today having to look at all those other possible budget cuts. And the problem we're in, the box we're in right now, is that a lot of those things that were on the board today in the conference room were small ticket items. Even if you took every last one of those issues on that board, it doesn't get us our $5 million without changing media techs and media tech literacy. It just doesn't get us there. It doesn't get us there. You look at federal funding with Title I's, you can't look at Title I money because that's federal grant money. It doesn't help us balance our budget. Not at all. So there's a lot of competing interests that we have to, I agonize over this. Because what I was going to say is that my goal, even in this first round, was never to displace anyone. Not a soul I wanted to displace. Still don't want to displace anybody. But what we do have to do is we have to look at the two competing pieces that the superintendent stuck in the middle of, not so much superintendent, but this district. And that is, how do we plug a $19.5 million budget hole while at the same time getting this district further down that student achievement spectrum? Can we afford to hold back another year? I don't think so. We've got kids flying through this district each and every day. We're not afforded the opportunity to pull it on a sidetrack and repaint and reupholster and tinker and make it, you know, what we want it to be and what we want it to look like, and then pull it back onto the main line and pick up speed. These kids are flying through the system each and every day. You know that better than I, because you deal with it. You see it every day. Every day. So a lot of decisions. I've not settled on anything yet. We are still tinkering and fine-tuning. But I wanted to be honest and upfront with you today on where the superintendent was coming from and why the superintendent wants to move the district in the direction that we're moving. That being said, Amelia, I'll take questions now. Do you want to finish or?
Well, we can take some questions and then I can go back.
Michelle, yes.
My question is, like at our school, we're at the A school and we're having, they require full-time literacy specialists. At our school, we have the difficulty that our literacy specialists are so involved in the paperwork and that process that how would they ever be able to do any tech or media or be able to fill that role? That would just be impossible.
Well, the question was about DA schools, differentiated accountability schools, the Coochie Elementary School being one, I think Hudson Elementary being the other. 5A High School, not quite there, but maybe, depending on what their school grade is this year, but those are the three schools we have to look at. They're going to be playing by a different set of rules. Different set of rules. Matter of fact, we have a meeting with the state tomorrow dealing with Lacoochee and Hudson Elementary and the possibility of Hudson High School. And my goal, Michelle, is to get Lacoochee Elementary School and Hudson Elementary School and 5A High School off the list. And we are going to do whatever it takes whether it's differentiated pay, whether it's extended school days, whether it is, we have got to do something for those kids in those schools. Can those kids learn in those schools? You betcha they can. But I'll tell you, those places are tough to teach. My wife's a school nurse. I'll just tell you, you know, many of you know that. Lacoochee Elementary School is her school. She also has Rodney B. Cox Elementary School. Now, she loves those communities, absolutely loves them. And I've been in those schools. I was volunteering at Cox Elementary School for about 8 months when I was retired, and I failed at that. Not volunteering, but the retirement piece. But these kids learn differently. These kids learn differently, and there's great teachers there. But I will also tell you, particularly at Cox Elementary or Lacoochee, there's almost a 50% staff turnover every year. Every year, there's not consistency there. Every year, because you know why? That's hard work. It's hard everywhere, but it is hard work at Lacoochee. It is hard work at Rodney B. Cox. So we understand that. DA schools are working by different set of rules. Was there a question in the front row?
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. Hi, Jennifer Wood from Wire Grass Elementary School. We'd really like to ask you about the one position for high school. We have too much technology to have one person. There is just no.
The question, the comment is there's just too much work at the high school level, and I use the high school level since that was your question, to be able to combine these positions and get it all done. Let me make a couple comments on that, and certainly Amelia can chime in on. Something else I found is that I've been looking is that the core competencies for media specialists are here. And they're the same for all media specialists, let's say at the high school level. They're all the same for elementary, all the same for middle schools. We don't differentiate that. But what I'm also finding is that the responsibilities or the job duties, and I put that in quote, vary from school to school. And the reason being, because many of you have said from this dais, and I again taking copious notes, that I'm in charge of the Scholastic Book Fair. I'm a class sponsor. I coordinate the senior projects. I do bus duty. I'm involved with lunch duty. I help kids with X, Y, or Z. And what I'm finding is there is no consistency across the district with what media specialists do. And other than the core competencies. Now, I'm not making this stuff up, but I'm just telling you, being blunt and bold with you and honest with you, is that the core competencies are there, but every school, the list differs. Depending on what your principal may have asked you to do, what your AP may have asked you to do, what you voluntarily may have taken on yourself. You might be involved with sports at the high school level. You might be coaching a team. You might be helping on field trips. You might be doing whatever the case may be. So I have to stop and give pause that says, if in fact, you're this sounds bad the way it sounds, but I gotta say it. If you're too busy, then is it too busy with things that aren't correlated? And my point being is that we've got to get back to the core of what we do as media specialists.
I brought you guys this stuff, because this is where we need to be 2015-2016 for the state of Florida when it comes to digital learning. And we don't, I'm trying to bring in e-books. You know, I'm looking at kids today testing on computers, but yet they don't know how to read on computers, and I'm worried about that. Because we need e-books, we need digital textbooks in their hands, and we need devices, and there's so many other things, and we've got 2 years to do it.
So your high school has 2,100 kids.
You got okay? That, yes,
so
we do.
The formula still accounts for the size of the school. Okay, in terms of the media tech assistants and in terms of this position, this whole position that we're looking at. Even if we do not have the funds to fill all the positions this year, the formula is still going to account for the size of the school. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
For both sides, okay. It's still going to. Now, we don't know that we're going to have the funds to to live to the formula, but we are not decreasing the formula for based on the population. We are, because it's true. It's different in a school that has 2,100 kids and a school that is doing what Wiregrass is doing. I also do think that we have to use Wiregrass as a learning lab. And looking at Wiregrass as a learning lab for all the other high schools, how would I allocate resources in a different way for Wiregrass, but also give you responsibilities to build the capacity across the board?
Let me also say that one of the things that we want to look at, and I say long-term because we're not going to get to it this coming year, but I think when we look at technology specialists, everybody sees them as computer repairmen. They see them as the one that has to fix the computers. And I'm saying that isn't the purpose of a technology specialist. What we need to be doing is setting up a process in this district within these feeder patterns so that we have what we would call geek squads that can go around and physically fix computers. We need to make sure that our technology specialists are instructional when it comes to the e-readers and the digital literacy and those kinds of things. And literally, there is about 95% bleed over between media specialists and technology specialists. And so when you start looking at these things, we have to ask ourselves the hard questions is to how we support those schools, how we provide those services, and we want to make sure, based on the formulas that we have in place to make sure that you get the numbers you need, is that we don't leave teachers hanging high and dry.
There is a lot of manual labor when it goes to getting that technology out there. I have over 100 iPads alone, because we have 150 iPads out every day. We have to check emails, we have to check, because there are so much kids that put things on that are inappropriate. There are so many restrictions that we have to do and manually have to check all the time, but if we don't, then that technology doesn't get out there. And I would love to call a geek squad and say, hey, will you add that app for me for 120?
Are you the media specialist or tech specialist?
I'm the media specialist, okay. Yes.
Yeah. I think also, do you mind?
No, go ahead.
I think also, in speaking to our tech specialist is wonderful, Lena. Lena LaBarbe, I'm at Langley High School. We are fortunate to where we have two media specialists. I get everything, I understand everything. I think the concern is what your thoughts are. The geek squad sounds like a great idea, but the teachers are freaking out because if something was wrong in the middle of the lesson, you say, what is the technology specialist? Our technology specialist, she is busy all the time, whether it's helping, software updates, going into the classrooms to help this teacher do that, getting the new, switching computers, getting rid of all the old computers, it's doing the one-on-one iPads, the updates, the this and that, we do share responsibility. She's had to teach me her job because one of her is not enough.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that scares us in the sense that we're thinking, you're saying, oh my gosh, one person can do this. We're going, oh my gosh, there's a couple of us doing it and we can barely handle it. So I guess that's where the scare comes from, because I just wanted to let you know that.
You want to restate that question, the point? Restate the point so that our viewers will.
I want to do justice to you, so I hope I can do it well. Your name again?
Lena.
Lena from Lando Lakes High School brought up the fact that she has a wonderful technology specialist. She started with that, and she has two media folks working over there, and the technology specialist is busy all the time. And she also has learned how to do some of the same jobs so she can help with the demand. And the fear is, if there's not somebody right there, what is going to happen when something goes wrong in a classroom? So is that okay? Is
correct.
That it?
Okay. All right.
Minute
to minute.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, based on what you said earlier about the overlap that you kept hearing at meeting the other night, a lot of that is because of the split situation in elementary schools. The tech's not there one day, the media's not there one day. Everybody's got to learn everybody's job or we can't make it through a day.
Okay. The point was, is that the reason that, and you are from where?
I'm from Deer Park.
I'm thinking that we combine these positions, and you tell me if I'm misstating this, is that you're almost forced into supporting each other because there's so much work that has to be done that tech becomes media and media becomes tech.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Okay. So let me kind of tell. Oh,
I mean, I'll get out of the way.
No, don't get out of the way, stay here. But I kind of want to share the rest of the story. And remember what I said at the beginning, it is going to be a multi-year, because even if we do not have all the funds this year to be where we want to be, the direction that we are going is going, we really believe is going to take us where we need to go. So right now, we kind of have to prioritize our time, prioritize our roles and responsibilities, but we believe the direction we are going is going to take us to every kid being college, career, and life ready, okay? So let me go back to this, because I told you we kind of divided the district into four different regions. And we tried to group the schools, the regions, the schools within the region in a manner that they had similar needs, okay? So this is what we're doing. I told you each region has a learning community executive director. The learning community executive director cannot do everything by themselves. So they need a regional support team. On the original plan that went to the board, the original proposal was that we were going to put all of the media and all of the technology special, all of the media and all of the literacy specialists back in the classroom, but then create this combination job that would allow us to buy back about 30 positions that were going to be spread throughout the regions, okay? And the feedback I got from multiple people is putting those positions in the regions in a manner that they you would not have a full-time person that has the media literacy background is not going to help us with Common Core. And I had breakfast with some of you, I had, you know, but we heard you. And the board also heard you. So we went back, and when Superintendent Browning first spoke about this plan, he said next year, the technology specialists are also going to be looked at. Because at first we are going to achieve this new status in 2 years. But when the board said, I want something different, we decided to go ahead and accelerate the proposal. And this is what we are looking at. So the regional support teams would include the Learning Community Executive Director, Common Core Specialists. These people are now district coaches, and their jobs are going to be put directly in the region, and these jobs are going to be open. So there will be a total of two Common Core Specialists per region, one focusing on literacy and one focusing on STEM, math specialty. Staff Development Specialists, these jobs now are called Race to the Top. They are grant, all of these jobs are grant funded. It's the Race to the Top coaches. Again, they have been district based. We're going to put them in the regions, one per region. The ICT specialist, and this is the job that I want to talk to you guys about. By doing what we are doing, putting everybody, and this is a proposal, okay? By putting the tech, the literacy, and the media in the circle. And then working with the research, looking at Common Core. Common Core has a whole strand on speaking and listening, reading, writing, right? So looking at in media technology is built in throughout. It's embedded, beginning in K. So looking at those key skills that kids need to demonstrate once they leave us, but throughout. We started looking at the research, and Wendy and Jay started working on the job description of the future, okay? And then they drafted something, and then they started pulling some media, technology specialists, and literacy coaches to start providing input. But when we looked at the regional supports, at first, we were going to have just a total of 30 of those people. And the technology specialists were going to continue to be half-time at the elementary and full-time at the secondary. When the board told us to relook at this, that changed. In the new proposal, each region is going to have what I call a super person, because this is a super person. The ICT literacy coach and literacy specialist is really the well-rounded person that we want to provide the expertise and build the capacity of our teachers and leaders in the school. So we're gonna have 4 ICT specialists, 1 per region. MTSS specialists, they have been there. We have 2 filled right now, but it's going to be 1 per region, so not new positions. Compliance specialists, not new positions, they have existed, but in our district transformation, we had over 65 adults that their full-time job was paperwork. ESE paperwork, or 504 paperwork, or ELL paperwork. Now, that's an important job. We don't wanna lose money, right? We don't. We don't wanna go to IEP jail. None of us do. At the same time, we are collapsing the compliance piece. So we're going to have compliance specialists that serve as compliance, ESE, 504, or ELL. Okay? And then we are also going to be able to have network specialists. 4 per region, 2 paid out of grant and 2 paid out of general revenue. The network specialist would be a part of your geek squad, kindly referred to. Yes?
The ICT specialist, in one region, you're going to have high schools, middle schools, elementary schools. Okay. I've been working with Common Core this year and working with my teachers with it, and it was very difficult to help them to fill that technology, the role that they have to fill for being able to get up there and be able to articulate, you know, what they want to, like, in speeches.
I agree. So what you don't see here, Michelle, is the ICT coaches. On the other, the prior proposal, there were 26 ICT coaches only. In the new proposal, by putting everybody in the mix, we will have 1 ICT coach per school. Okay? And the ICT coach, again, it does reflect the core skills of the future. It is a mixture of technology, media, and literacy. So we will be able to have 1 per school, at least. In a few schools, we have 2 because of the size, but 1 per school. And that will provide better supports. In the new plan, we will also be able to keep a full-time instructional media tech assistant. So let me repeat this. In the old model, you had 1 ICT specialist per region and 26 ICT coaches spread throughout the regions, and the technology specialists were not touched. In the new proposed model, we have 4 ICT specialists, 1 per region. We have 80 ICT coaches, 1 per school, and each school will have at least 1 media tech assistant. Yes?
I'm sorry, could you just address how you're gonna deal with larger populations of schools?
The formula has not changed. So the same formula that was there in the past to allocate media tech assistants, or?
I'm talking about the
ICT
coach.
So right now you have 2?
We have 3. We have 2 full-time media specialists.
We will not be able to have 3. I know that for sure.
No,
but
fine.
In the formula, you have 3. You will just be allocated 2, but you cannot have, because of the cuts.
We'll have 2 of what?
Of the ICT coaches.
And
2 ICT coaches. So in the future, you are not going to.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but the formula has not changed. In the formula, you earned 3, but you will not be able to get it.
Okay.
Okay? So the way this is going to go, if, yes?
I think that they didn't quite, can you repeat how
how you were chosen. I think the same situation is at some of the other larger high schools, and I think
that have two media specialists and one tech.
And again, we will not be able to fill all the positions this year. The formula has not changed, but some of the positions will be frozen because of the funds. Okay, so we will not be able to tell you hard numbers until we know what the legislation does. That's when we will know exactly what comes down. But let me talk to you a little bit. If the board approves this new plan, which you are not the only people in the mix of cuts, but we are addressing you today. So let me talk to you a little bit. With Jay, Vanessa, and Wendy's assistance, if the board approves this plan, we are going to go ahead and take the ICT coach and the ICT specialist job description to the board, okay? And we will create, people will have the opportunity to apply to be in the pool. And then principals will be able to interview who they want to hire. Okay? Questions? Yes?
My concern is with the network specialists. We have four in each region, right? And I'm just, you know, getting down to the reality of it. I mean, just with that PAT testing this week, you know, if my network specialist isn't around, I mean, it happened to me today when we were doing makeups, you know, we had a problem with students getting on, they were getting picked off. It was a little deeper than what I knew about it, you know? So, I mean, when it gets, you know, past a certain time or problem, you know, I have to go to my tech specialist. How do we deal with that?
What I can tell you is that we agree with you and we recognize that. We really do. And so the goal is, as funds become available, we would increase that. Because that is what other counties are doing.
That's crucial.
They are not instructional, though. They are technicians.
Right, I understand.
And like the schools that have gone towards that, like Sarasota, for example. Sarasota doesn't have literacy coaches full-time, and they don't have media specialists. They just cut the secondary. They haven't had elementary in a long time. But what they have is they have this mixed position, and then they have a technician.
Okay. They're
in the school.
Okay. That's
next
ideal.
Year.
I mean,
but we are not there. Remember, multi-year. We are
but
not
that's
there.
The vision.
So we have, yes, but we have to prioritize. So we know we can start with four. Then at least if we can go to one per feeder pattern, and then they can be housed in a high school, okay? And then we increase,
right.
Absolutely. But we have to prioritize. And what we heard is what you do matters a lot. But because we cannot have one of this, and one of this, but when we look at Common Core, we see that the group of skills that are needed, that's what we're going for. Yes, Michelle.
My question is that you have specific training that is done, I mean, I have a master's degree to be a media specialist. You have specific training that's done to be a tech specialist. Now you're asking for us to apply to a pool that's going to be a mix of all this. Literacy coaches get to go to specific training. What's going to be out there to help us to be able to meld these jobs and to make it into the pool? It seems very unfair. I mean, I got a master's degree in media.
Okay.
I'm not educated, but I may not have the skills you're speaking.
Michelle, I'm going to let Jay and Wendy speak to that because they were part of the group. I was not involved in creating. That's not my area. But I completely trust what they have done, so I'm going to let them talk about that.
As we've worked on these job descriptions, we took the media specialist and the tech specialist job descriptions initially, and as Amelia and Mr. Browning recognized, 95% of those were common. So as we look towards this job description, the technical aspects that we have on the tech specialist, that is not one of the core competencies that we'll be looking at. We'll be looking at that integration of instructional technology that all of our media and tech specialists have had training in, because that's the way we've been moving the last few years. So, and the literacy piece, we worked with some literacy coaches as well, and as I've looked at that, and I don't have that literacy background, but I do know that as a media specialist, literacy was also considered one of my core competencies. So I think that our specialists that have been moving forward with that integration of technology into their day-to-day practice and into the teaching and learning of their students are going to find that they do have those qualifications. I know that there was a draft job description that was published. There has been additional work on that. But I think that when you actually see these job descriptions, you will find that the competencies that we're asking for are not going to be foreign to you based on what we've been moving towards.
And remember.
Jay, you want to add anything?
Yeah, Jay, come up. But remember that what Common Core requires, it requires of everybody. So we need to build the capacity of people to do what Common Core requires. And I cannot count on one or two or three adults in the building to be able to implement the integration that Common Core English Language Arts requires. I need to be able to build the capacity of teachers that are in front of kids. So by creating this ICT literacy coach position, it's not that I don't think you are important in the media center, but I really respect your skills. I'm going to give a media instructional assistant to be in the media, and you will have input, but I need you to take your skills to the classrooms too. It cannot just stay in the media. You will see your results going faster. Listen to me, this is different. You will see your results, what you know, multiplying by working through the adults in the school.
May I add one more thing, Jennifer, and then I promise.
If
you recall, when we moved back a few years ago with the LFS coaching, and at that point we started talking about rather than thinking of going and providing that direct instruction to students, what we needed to be doing was coaching the teacher. So when you were providing that direct instruction, to be thinking of it as modeling for the teachers and building their capacity to be able to teach those skills to their students directly. That is going to be key for Common Core, because as Amelia said, that kind of instruction needs to be happening in every classroom every day for all of our students. And I know when I was a media specialist, when I had to depend on finding the right, for teachers to collaborate with me, for me to do those integrated lessons, I wasn't reaching all of my students. And no matter how hard I tried, that, trying to provide that direct instruction through collaboration with teachers was not reaching all of my students. But when you're coaching teachers and modeling for them and then leading them to that independent application of teaching those skills, that's when we're going to be reaching all of our students. And that is, what the job descriptions focus on, that coaching role that you've been moving into for many years.
I'm going to hit this on too. When you go back to our original job descriptions for tech specialists as well, for many years now, as we reflect back on those job descriptions, all of our techs will from time to time say, well, that's not what we were hired to do, the job we're doing right now. Okay, which includes a lot of break and fix, a lot of management of hardware and software and things of that nature, which takes us farther and farther really from our role. This role that we've put together now, this new job description, gets back to the essence of what it is we've always been trying to do since the beginning, and Wendy and Amelia both told you more about that. The rest of the responsibilities, if you look in those roles too, we head up there a little earlier, but those network people, media tech assistants and all too, that break and fix role gets teased out of that, what a tech specialist would be doing, okay, and taken on, by these other groups for support. So that's what's taken away. And that's what we're associating with. When you think of a tech specialist role right now, you're thinking of, well, who's gonna roll out all the equipment? Who's gonna manage all this hardware? Who's gonna, fix all these things when they break? That is going to be addressed differently than what we're doing right now. That changes the role of that instructional trainer, and coach.
By who?
Well, that's the thing. We've got network assistants. We've got people now will be assigned to each region to start dealing with that hardware.
We also have to be empowering our teachers, and we've been talking about that for many years as well. Teachers, we need to also be able to support their own technology. And As more and more technology, as we move to digital learning, and you know, there's all of this technology in every classroom, building the capacity of teachers to troubleshoot and all is going to be one of the necessary things to do. Okay. I know Jennifer.
Now, let me ask you this also for the sake of time, okay? What we'd like for you to do is write down some questions, and we'll collect those right now too, so we can address those. But have we got?
We can do like 10 more minutes of questions, and then the rest we'll take it and we'll answer and post it.
Okay, all right.
I know Jennifer had her hand up and interrupted her, so if I.
This is for you. I think you know a lot of us are in the classroom. We're doing this, and we embrace doing that. That's my favorite part. No, we'll find you the perfect book for service too, but we'll get into that later because that's so important too.
Yeah, it is.
But, you know, I just hope that this position will still be the hub of the media center that they know where people know to go. Because, you know, it's like in any public community, people have to know where to seek the person that they need for assistance. Is that what you're envisioning or?
Well, I think we need to learn what the children demands from us, what the job demands from us. But this is like, I was just in Ann Arbor and I visited Michigan and I looked, I visited their library and they have one that is like beautiful and very traditional, like awesome. But then I started going into the colleges and I went into the business college and the way things are set up, it's very different. Now, I know that that's post-secondary, okay? But that is what you are seeing more and more. Kids will learn in and out when they are in school and when they are away. It's 24/7. So I do think that our future, not only for the media center, our future is gonna look very different.
Well, our PASCO vision for 2020 is to make us community centers.
Correct.
Because we don't have enough public libraries to support our community as is. So, I completely understand where we are. One other thing, I'm sorry, I'm not trying, but another thing we really need to address too is I think we need to look at how administration envisions us. Because I think that
we know.
Okay. I'm not going to say
that. We are being taped.
Okay. No, I love my administrator.
I know. He's lying. Yes, great laundry.
He really does support us.
He does.
Christian.
I'll stay close in case it's fine.
You have not addressed training. I believe it's probably one of the weakest links that we have in this county. Other counties have half days. How are you addressing training? You know, it's going to take, this is a big learning curve this present summer coming up. And I don't know how this is going to happen. I honestly don't know how it's going to happen. So I'd be happy to get that information.
We do have plans, but we're going to share it with the principals before we share it with everybody else. Plus, our plans have to really pend board approval for the final cuts. But we do have plans of training that would start in May, and it would be open to different people across. It doesn't matter if you're going to have this job or not. But June, we're going to have training. So we are also talking about trainings for media tech assistants. Because the last time their job description was updated was 1994. So we are updating, we're updating that too, and we recognize they also need help.
How about a pool for them? Because my assistant's only been there 3 months. She doesn't know any technology. She has no clue what she's gonna be faced with and thrown at her. Maybe we need to have some, maybe we need to see what capacity is out there.
That
too. I'm sorry.
I'll leave that up to them.
That was my biggest fear, was leaving her alone in the library.
That would be something to consider.
I just want
three more questions and
clarification. So what you're proposing to the board is everybody's out and you have to apply to be the ICT coach.
Kevin, do you want to talk about like how the process will work?
I think the question is really how is the transfer process and the staffing going to work based on the new model? And I know for the media specialists, I think you all were expecting getting transfer preference forms next week through the process that's going to be panning out at the schools. That is probably not going to be the case now because we're not sure what direction things are going. So when those preference forms go to the schools next week, it's probably only going to be
for those basic education teachers that are going to need placement because of allocation shifts or student enrollment. Once the board finalizes a plan, we will then decide who do we need to give preference forms, how will we assist those people in transitioning. We're going to look at the timelines for the ICT position, that pool process, how we can get those positions out there and advertised for those of you who are interested in filling those positions. It is still our objective, once the board makes its decision, to come up with a plan that will help everybody transition into something, whether it's into these ICT positions or whether it's into another position that you're certified or highly qualified for. We are going to continue to work with everyone to try and make sure that you've got a home going into next year. But it's really going to depend on what the board approves before we can lay out the transition plans for the people that are going to be impacted. So.
Right.
I just want to, I'm an assistant. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many others are here. Mm-hmm. I've been through every one of these meetings and every one of these things. When you realign our job descriptions and you take the people who we support and who support us away from us, mm-hmm. are you going to realign everything else, like pay?
Well, I mean, everything's going to be on the table, and that's something the union has brought forward as well. I said, with all of these transitions, we're probably going to have to look, at compensation, and we may come to the table saying that we need to talk about how some of these structures work so that pay is commensurate with duties. But again, we're really not in a position to know what that structure is going to be until the board gives us the go-ahead on what the plan is going to be moving forward. So at this point, everything's kind of on hold relative to the staff impacts until after May 7th, and we know what direction the district's going to be going at that point.
We'll take a couple more questions, but then please write down your questions, and we'll be happy to answer and post it. Yes. Yeah.
I would like to know who will be interviewing applicants for the pool.
Okay, it's going to be a team, but it's going to have Jay, it's going to have Wendy, it's going to have someone from teaching and learning, so it's going to be a team. Two more? Okay, I'll go to people that have, I'll take three more. Okay, you first?
Will Title I schools have the opportunity to purchase more than one?
Yes. Title I schools, but as you know, because a lot of our Title I schools are not getting the desired results with how they have been spending their money, we really are trying to help them. Because what we did with Title I is we looked at the schools that are getting good return for investment, and we looked at the ones that were not. And what we found is they were spending their money in a very similar way. But then we started looking at the systems that they had created in the building, and that was the difference. So we're trying, like right now, Chester Taylor has an incredible system for intervention teachers. It's so tight, it works beautifully. So we are inviting other Title I schools to go see that. Another Title I school might have something different. So we are trying to pair them up, but yes, that would be a possibility for a Title I school, definitely. You and then you?
I don't have a question. I just want to share. Last year I worked with many of you as a trainer coach and also as a media specialist. We've all been on pins and needles for years. When is this going to happen? When is that going to happen? We're taking on more technology. This may be, we need to be a little open-minded. No one wants to lose their position, but we're already in that position. This may be what we've been looking for. For what you're doing, we're already teaching information. Maybe then we don't have lunch duties and all. Maybe this is going to make our position value. Did you hear that?
No lunch.
And that's what I'm saying. I mean, we need to really think, and I'm telling you, looking at the big picture, being in many of your schools, working with you, seeing the amazing things that are happening out there. But now, I think the concern is, are we combining three jobs? Like, are you expecting literacy?
So let me repeat that question, because that's a great question. The question was, are you combining three jobs? No. What we're combining is the key responsibilities and roles that you need to have to be successful in the 21st century. Okay? And how you can be a coach for that to happen. So no, you are a problem solver and you are an evaluator and you are a it's one job description, but it reflects the needs of the future.
That's a great question. It can't stay the same, and we all know that. We've done it the last few years.
But it's not only, lots have to change. The job of the principal has to change. The job of the assistant principal has to change. The job of the district office has to change. Yes.
And my question is, this is sort of personal. A lot of those positions have interest for me. But there's the timeline for when each one will I know what they are, what the responsibilities, what to pay, and when they're being advertised, be close enough together to where you can make a decision where to go, or is it going to be this one first and later that one?
The attention now is ICT first. The ICT coach comes first. So the job descriptions have been finalized. We are just working on details, but they have been finalized. So that once the board approves, that will come first, because that will be 80 possible positions.
Before the supervisors.
Before the specialists, yes. Yeah. So that will come first.
So but we won't have job descriptions for the other ones until
yes.
after that.
Last one, yes.
Once people get in the pool for the ICT, then if they get approved to get in the pool, will they then have to interview at each school that they want to work at?
Once you are in the pool, you would interview with in any school that you are interested in working. We're not going to assign you to a school. You are going to be the school's employee. So you, if I like this school and this school and this school, you would be able to interview in multiple places. Okay. Please, we want to continue this conversation, but I know time is running out. So write down your questions, and we are going to continue to post the answers online. Right, Wendy? We already got a lot of your questions, and Wendy has worked on answering them with Dr. Min and Jay, so we're going to continue to take your questions and submit the answers online.